We know that we have a equation that initially we have taught you x cells, right? Maybe not me, some other professor. But at the first stage, you were introduced to x cells. Then you are being introduced to Fortran. So what is the need of learning x cells? Anyone? Kindly answer. Any thought that comes to your mind? Any thought?
Sir, it is very much helpful for tabulating data in any order, either ascending, descending, for doing large sum of calculation within few seconds, and also tabulating it in form of different charts or bar graph and histogram and as such.
Okay, so Excel, so because we have already done only for Excel part, you guys might be knowing that Excel has some inbuilt functions, right? Like standard, deviation, average, mean, all, correct? So the question is, if we can do all those calculations in Excel, what is the need of learning any programming language? That is the question. So we have chosen Fortran here, as because all the programming languages are almost the same. Those who know the C and C++ Java, they might be find it very easy. So there is a special reason for learning Fortran here, because the Fortran software is easy. The compiler can be easily available in the online mode. But the fundamental question is, if we can do all different kind of calculations in Excel with predefining function, then what is the need of learning any kind of programming language, right? For our particular contextual example, our example is Fortran. So kindly answer. What is the use of learning a programming language? Okay, let me modify my question. How many of you were interested in going to software companies after you had the completion of your fourth year? Anyone? No one is interested in going to
yes,
software
sir.
Company.
So you're
interested. Okay. So how many programming languages you have learned?
Sir, I have learned total C and some of the C++.
Data structure. Okay. So Fortran is almost similar as C. So those who will be joining a software company after the computer fourth year, any kind of programming language will definitely help them. That is with no doubt, right? But the second part of the question is, if someone is interested in higher studies, say for example, MPhil or PhD, how this programming language can be helpful for them? Any idea?
Sir, we will be able to run the software because we will be knowing that how they have been made. So it will be much easier to execute them.
No. I didn't get
it. Sir, it will be easy to use in case of research or thesis.
Yes, that is my exact question. Huh? That how any programming language will be helping you in terms of your MTech or PhD
research. Sir, it can be helpful for running simulations and other computings, which will be difficult to do by hand.
Okay, and that cannot be done with Excel?
Sir, if a programming language is there, then it should be more smarter than Excel.
Okay, let me ask you another question. See, the example we will be showing you here in this class, that will be adding up 2, 3 numbers, A, B, and C, or finding out the average or factorial, right? Those simple basic programs. But those simple basic programs can be done with Excel only. So what is the need of learning Fortran then? Did you get my If you get my particular question, the examples we will be discussing here, that is particularly simple examples, right? So those kind of simple examples can be done with Excel also, with predefined preset function. Then what is the need of learning any programming language? See, you have talked about simulation, right, in your M-Tech thesis. So, say for example, if you are doing a modeling kind of thing in your M-Tech, without much help in your experimental laboratory work. So, Excel or any kind of predefined software will not provide you that kind of flexibility that you can model or you can code your own program, right? Average you can do with Excel, average you can do with Fortran also. But typical calculation as per your own contextual need, that cannot be done with Excel, isn't it? That can be partly done with Excel, but Excel will not give you 100% freedom for achieving those things. Now, if you know Excel and the programming language, say for example, C or Fortran, then at your MTech or your PhD, it is completely your choice that your particular job you will be interested in doing in either in Excel or in Fortran. Right? Got it? Got the idea? See, Excel also has some backend programming running. Isn't it? You just mention a simple word equal to average, and Excel will give you some options and it will calculate the average in not more than a fraction of a second. So, some kind of programming or coding is also running in background of Excel. So, any kind of programming language will give you enough freedom so that you can do a modeling thing as per your own contextual need, correct? So now we'll start Fortran. So a general introduction of Fortran is, Fortran was created by a team led by John Bennett at IBM, 1957. So IBM has developed this term, Fortran. Initially, Fortran referred to what was written in capital, in caps, F in cap, O in cap, R in cap, everything is cap. It's just nomenclature kind of thing. But current standards and the implementations only require the first letter to be capital. Fortran stands for, see, this particular point. Fortran stands for formula translator. Then they have taken this forward from this formula and this transferred from this translator and combine them two and has converted to. So, from this name itself, you can see that Fortran is the programming done for formulations, right? So, originally developed for the scientific calculations, it had very limited support for character strings and other structures needed for general purpose of programming. Now, the question when like that, sir, okay, what is the character, what is the string? Anyone knows all those things? Do you know C?
Yes.
So kindly explain what is the character, what is the string, and what is the other structure?
Sir, character is just a single alpha, single space
character. Single anything, right? Yes. Any keyboard option, right? You just simple. Words, any single keyboard key, there is a particular character. Okay, as because many of you already know some programming language, let me know if there is any one, who is not at all any kind of programming language or the programming language, the first thing for them today. Is there anyone? Hello?
Sir, what, sir?
Is there anyone in this VXPY class who doesn't know any kind of programming language? Is there anyone? No one. Hello? Hello?
Sir, in first semester only we have learned C.
Okay, so that is enough. If you know C, then you know, you already know Fokker, right? Then I could not describe each and every word. But if you know C, then how will you learn Fokker, or what is the fundamental difference between C and Fokker? There might be a slight change in syntax, right? Isn't it? So
yes,
as we go, I am assuming that everyone knows C a bit. So Fortran is no different from C, just some syntax changes, right? Okay. So latter extensions and development made into high-level programming language with good degree of portability. What is the portability in any programming language, and what is high level programming language, what is low level programming language? Any idea? First of all, what is high level programming language, what is low level programming language? Probably you guys know the answer, but still. See, computer. Not your screen, right? The CPU. The computer only understands the language of 1 and 0, isn't it? Everything is finally converted into the address, and everything is the electrical signal, that is 1 and 0. 1 means yes, 0 means no. So every character, every string, every programming code, everything in any that is input from our side is finally translated into 1 0 1 0, or a combination of 1 and 0. So that is the machine level language, right? And the programming we are doing here, that is the high level language that incorporates a very similar language and words of English language, right? As because see, there is a common right, printf. So this print particular word is the English keyword, right? So those who know English, he or she can understand what the programming is trying to say. Clear? So this is the high level programming language, and this is the low level programming language. So the programmer, we, the software engineers, do programming in high level programming language. Then something converted, translate it so that the machine or the computer itself can decode it and convert into machine language and execute the job. And because everything is done very fast, we turn the time interval there. Okay. Okay. One more question. There is a very common keyword, compiler, right? Fortran compiler, you will just get it online. There is also compiler C also. So what is the function of the compiler? Compiler exactly do in any kind of programming language, right? Anyone? Hello? Hello? Anyone? Anything? Just try to interpret from the English word compiler. What does compilation mean? What it can be, at least.
So it converts yes. High level language into lower level language.
Yes. So compiler, you can say that compiler is a translator. You are Japanese, I am Indian, I don't know your Japanese language, Japanese accent. So maybe one of our common friends, those who already knows Japanese as well as English, right? So he can work from both the end. So compiler does exactly the same job. Whatever coding we are writing here, that is compiled and converted into the machine language. That is the rule of the compiler. Okay. So again, one fundamental question is, we are still in here, right? We are not promoting you, or we are not inspiring you to go to the software company, right? Our intention is that we will be in such a way that you will go for the higher studies job, right? So we will learn for prime from the depth perspective only. So we will not go very deep into that what the compiler does and all, but we will Program that if you are interested in higher study, you will be able to do computational work, right? And in this former time, and because all of you know that laboratory is a completely closed, so if you have a strong background in programming, then even if this corona extends for infinite time, your at least MTech will not be hampered. Isn't it? You may be able to do a computational MT. Okay. So there are several versions of Fortran, right? Some original versions like Fortran 1, 2, and 3 are considered now obsolete. Why obsolete? Because modified Fortran or updated newer version of Fortran has gone, right? So the most commonly used versions today are Fortran 37, 19, 95. So after 95, we haven't updated this Fortran. Okay. So now we will be comparing with C, and we will be learning this Fortran. What is the basic syntax difference? So a Fortran program is made of a collection of program units, like the main program, modules, and external subprograms. Procedure. Now, what is this procedure term? What is this module term? What is the external program term? All of the terms we'll learn slowly, not all today. But today we will focus on this main program and maybe module. So each program contains one main program and may or may not contain other program units. Again, each program contains one main program and may or may not contain other program units. Means, if your programming is very simple, it should only contain your main program. But if your program is very much complicated, long program, thousands lines, codes, so they should have many subheaders, sub programs within it.
Hello.
But your programming should at least have one main program. That is the minimum requirement of this Fortran language. So the syntax of this main programming is program, then the name of the program. For this particular example, program underscore name. It is the name of a particular program. You can name it Konishko, you can name it Saurav, you can name it IPL, you can name it X, anything. But the syntax is you have to write program first so that the computer may understand that you are writing the main program heading here, and you have to assign a specific name to your program. It may be anything. Got it? And this thing doesn't end here. Come to the last line of this particular slide. End program, program name. So first of all, you are opening a program. This is the first cover page of your book, and it is the end page of your book. And in between, there can be 3 lines, there can be 1,000 lines, anything. But these two names have to be consistent. Right. Here it is mentioned program underscore name, but don't get confused with that. You can assign any name there. Okay. Up to this, any question or doubt? This is the most fundamental structure of a Fortran program, right? And in between, you may have various kind of sub programs, modules, external sub programs, procedures, anything that you will see later. But the basic fundamental thing is you have to declare a program then starting with program. This program word is the connection between you and Fortran. See, Fortran has chosen a few or many keywords already. So these keywords you cannot use in your writing, because you can think of this is active words. If you type program, it will think that you are trying to giving him some instructions, right? Okay, the next line you should write implicit none. What is the meaning of implicit none? Okay, what is the general meaning of implicit? Anyone? Implicit? Hello guys, am I audible? Hello?
Yes, sir, audible.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. What is the meaning? What is the English synonym of this term, implicit? Okay.
Indirect.
No. Okay. Implicit none means you are trying to instruct the computer that don't assume anything by your own. I will declare everything. Because at the initial stages, Fortran was a little bit backward language, right? So if you don't mention implicit none, they used to assume something. What kind of assumption? Variable. How? Read this sentence. The implicit none statement is used to inhibit a very old feature of Fortran that is almost obsolete today. That is, by default, treats all the variables that starts with the letter I, J, K, L, and F and A as integers, and all the other variables as real arguments. Implicit none should always be used. Got this point? In the older version of Fortran, if you don't mention anything, then they assume all those variables like I, J, those initial letters start with I, J, K, L, M, and N as integers. These were their datum assumption. But with this term implicit none, you are conveying that you don't do anything. You don't assume anything without my permission. Got it? So after writing this program and program name, you should always instruct the computer with this command, implicit none. It's a like general convention, right? Okay. Now we have mentioned here, right? This main program is there, modules are there. So at least you will see the general idea of module, right? Module. In a typical engineering programming application, it often the case that there are parameters, variables, and sub-programs that must be shared by several program units. Fortran 90 provides a special program unit known as module that conveniently packages collection of declarations and sub-programs so that they may be imported into other program unit also. So, same kind of variables, same kind of parameter. Once you have declared them, assigned them, you need not to declare them again and again, right? That is the need of having this module. Got the idea? Say, for example, you are doing a programming on Newton's mechanics, right? And there is a term of distance, time, acceleration, all. So maybe several formulas will use the same kind of S and T and U and V and all. So using this module thing, If you once declare what is A, what is U, what is T, what is V, you need not to declare them again and again, and your program can run absolutely. Got the idea? But we are just trying to have an overview of this Fortran language. We have done three classes, right? Today, I will give you just a simple introduction on Fortran. Next day, we will be doing some actual programming in our hand, with the hand, right? And the third day will be your exam kind of thing. You have to do one programming by your own in the stipulated 1 or 10 in the class. Got it? Hello?
Yes.
Okay. So now we'll see a very simple program in Fortran. Don't just ask me the sir, what is the need of Fortran for just adding up A and B? It is just an example. That is a very simple example. Okay. So here we will again declare a program, right? And we have named here as add numbers. So the command is program, and the program name is add number. You can assign anything, but we will prefer, we generally prefer to give a suitable name so that someone else can also identify the intention of the objective of this program, right? Now we will go to the previous slide. See here, program. They have mentioned program name with the underscore. My name. This program is the command, right? Then they have said program underscore name. So the question is why they have intentionally put an underscore there? Anyone?
So it means it can include characters and.
No, you're correct. It may include characters. That is why this programming is not showing an error. But my question was a little different. Why they have not put only program then program name? So the compiler might get confused. I don't know that with 100% guarantee all the compilers will get confused, but some of the compiler in some cases will give you some error, as because they might, again, they may or may not be considered the program name as your command, because this program term is the command. You cannot use it directly. Got it? Just say, for example, you are filling up a form, and in one section, they have asked to put your father's name. So, corresponding to the particular column, your father's name, you cannot say my father's name is father. Can you? But your father's name can be father. There is nothing wrong in having a name of father, right? But your form may not cancel, because they were expecting something else other than your keyword father, isn't it? So the same thing is happening here. And because they have used this program word, they have underscored it with a name so that the compiler see this program underscore name different word other than this different word program, right? Got the idea, right? Okay. Now, in a simple program, this program name is add numbers. Now, they have put an exclamation mark there and have mentioned that this simple program adds two numbers. So, what is the need of this exclamation mark? Anyone?
Sir, it will not be considered as the command statement.
Yes, it will not be considered as a command statement. But what is the need of that?
Sir, like after some time, if anyone else or we read this program, then we will be able to understand.
Exactly. It is not that much important for a 2-line code, but if you are writing a 1000-line code, you will get lost. So it will help you to identify this section of the code. It is act like a footnote, right? But any line starting with this particular sign will not be considered as a comment. Okay. Then again, implicit none. Then type declaration. Here we are dealing with real numbers. So this is the general syntax of Fortran. Real, then colon colon A comma B comma result. So this A, B and result, this we have assigned, right? Now the executable statement is A is equal to 12.0, B is equal to 15.0 and result equal to A plus B. Can anyone tell me what is this 12.0, why they have not mentioned 12 only? So similar to C, that you have to assign what kind of variables, what kind of inputs are you are trying to store in this A, B and result, right? Whenever you are assigning these variables named with A, B and C and whatever, the computer then reserving a particular storage corresponding to this A, B result and all. So you have to also instruct the computer that with this, in this storage, we are going to store this type of things. So the type of the storage also needs to be defined. So here one type is real. Real means your number can be 16.75. Your number can be 16 only, but your number cannot be 16 plus 4i. It cannot be a complex variable, right? If you have to deal with this complex number, then you have to assign a complex storage for that, or a storage that will be able to handle those complex numbers. Now, result equal to A plus B, print star, comma, the total is, comma, result. Then end program at number. And because you have started the program with program at number. Now you are running that particular program. Right? So when we compile it and execute the above program, it will be giving a total is 27.000000. That's because you have taken the variable type real there. If you would have taken the variable type as integer, right, then it will be only 27. Correct? Okay. This we have already covered. Compilation means to transfer. Okay. This we have covered, right? Object code. Please note that all the programs start with a keyword program and end with a keyword end program. Okay. We have covered implicit none, we have covered comments in Fortran with exclamation marks, we have covered the printster function, okay, indentation, okay. Another important thing is indentation of code lines, the good practice of keeping a program readable. What is that? What is the example of indentation? This is indentation. Indentation is not required, it is not mandatory, but it is appreciable always. Why? Because indentation refers to the spaces at the beginning of a code line, where in other programming language, indentation of the code is for readability only. The indentation in Python is very important. How many of you knows Python?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir. So in Python, indentation is utmost important, right? But in Fortran also, if you can do it, it will be helpful for you to understand what is happening. So indentation is done by these spaces, tabs, right? So that it may have a proper paragraph kind of thing. You may clearly understand that this particular, can you guys see my arrow?
Yes, sir.
Particular section comes under this. This is the main part, right? So this is the rule for having indentation in your fortran. Okay. And one last point that there was, fortran allows both the uppercase and lowercase letter. Fortran is case sensitive. So those who have designed fortran, right? They have said that, okay, we will be considering uppercase and lowercase. Maybe one particular type of program may not allow uppercase, lowercase. Maybe there is no such difference between upper and lower cases. But in Fortran, particularly in this case, sensitive, and it allows both the uppercase and lowercase. What does it mean? If you have assigned a variable with caps, then you have to always be consistent in assigning the particular variable in caps.
So much here it is written, fourth is case insensitive.
Okay, case insensitive. I thought it is case sensitive. Okay, then completely opposite statement. I was confusing with it. Okay. Fortran allows, thank you. Fortran allows both uppercase and lowercase because Fortran is case insensitive. Means Fortran doesn't see any difference between capital A and small a. Okay.
Just a point here, this is Dr. Devankara. Students, I have handled a lot of versions of Fortran. I do not agree or disagree with this statement because it depends on the compiler. I have seen some compilers which are totally case sensitive. I have seen certain compilers which are totally case insensitive. So what I advise is better to be on the safe side, assume it to be case sensitive. If you see that for the particular compiler, if you want to print something, you have to go with a small p, better go with a small p. Because if you assume it is a case sensitive, even if it is insensitive, it will not make a difference. But the other way around would create a problem. This entire statement is dependent on the compiler time. Like for example, I have provided in the chat box as well as uploaded in the Google Classroom, just an online compiler. Why? Because if you download Fortran, it doesn't occupy a very high MBS matlab. So that problem of space or memory is not there, but from version to version, this problem of case sensitivity or case insensitivity or some of the keywords, they hugely vary. Like in the one you see now with exclamation, what Sir was just now explaining, that if you try to give an exclamation mark, then it understands that it is not an executable statement, it is just a plain and simple comment. I have seen certain compilers where this starts with C, a small c or a capital C. So better you work always with the online compiler, the link of which I have provided in the chat. This compiler, as far as I have seen it, the one which is the online compiler, it's more or less case insensitive, and the exclamation mark also works here. So first in today's class, let us give you a brief preview of the different commands, because what you have learned about C and C++ was in your first years, and some of you had the opportunity to learn some other kind of programming languages. But we will assume that you are all on the same platform. You just had a review of C language in your first year, and you all need a quick brush up regarding the same. So we will be starting with the different commands. We will be explaining to you the different statements. And what we have thought for you, Professor Konishka Vishwas and myself, better not impose upon you any kind of downloading, any use of any kind of either cracked version or full version. Go with this online compiler. You cannot save your program, but you can see the output. Okay. So let's start explaining to you in this class the different commands, the different methodologies, and we will have a hands-on experience. All of you can click the link later on when Sir is done. At least some basic problems for today we can run. Like Sir was just now giving you a very excellent example, just a basic example of how to just add two numbers or maybe subtract two numbers. So for today's class, we will stick to the basic mathematical operations. Next two classes, we will utilize this knowledge since we have all opted for a very beautiful branch of engineering, a core branch, civil, Monday and Thursday, we will devote more time in utilizing the principles we have learned today in solving simple engineering problems related to the five fundamental branches of civil engineering that you have been introduced: structural, transportation, geotechnical, environmental, as well as water. Thank you so much. Sorry, Dr. Vishwas, I just
interrupted you. Thank you for your
Thank you.
So, we have already covered. So, the basic character sets of Fortran contract is A to Z, caps A to Z, and small user and all the digits 0 to 9. Underscore character and some special. Yeah. Hello?
So I couldn't follow that indentation of code line.
Okay, indentation. Okay. See, indentation means making these spaces, these tabs, these tabs. If you follow the left hand side margin, right? It is not constant, right? Some of the codes have been shifted towards the right, isn't it? So we have intentionally done it. Why? See, first of all, even if you don't press tab or space or anything and don't make this indentation error, your code will run fine. No issue with that. But if your programming is 1,000 lines long, even if for you also, it might get problematic to identify which line belongs to which heading. Your code will look very, very flat. So for avoiding that thing, we have introduced a special term called indentation, where we make a space here when needed, so that later on we can easily identify the code. We can easily segmentize which part we are trying to focus on. Got it? It
yes,
is
sir.
Just like having an English character wise. Yes.
Okay,
you can focus on.
Slide.
Hmm?
Can you go back to the then the third line.
Yes.
Commencing Fortran has started with exclamation mark, and all the characters after this are ignored by the compiler. So what does it mean?
It means, okay, first we read this line. Commencing Fortran has started with an exclamation mark, as all characters after this except the character string are ignored by the compiler. Now we will ignore this except the character string, we'll discuss later, but without this exceptional case, say here, for this, say for example, this particular line we have started with an exclamation mark and written this simple program adds two numbers. Your compiler will ignore the entire line. Your compiler will ignore the entire line. It will not be shown to your result. It is just for your understanding. It is just a footnote kind of thing. It is just a heading that is for you only. Or your colleague with whom you will be sharing this code, he or she will be readily understand that what is the purpose of this particular programming or this particular segment, right? This is as a heading that is not for being compiled to the compiler. It is for your understanding. Got it?
Yes, sir.
With this particular exclamation sign, you are instructing the compiler that don't consider this like I have written anything just for my own purpose. It is not for you. There is nothing to be compiled here. You can write here anything, X, Y, Z, your name, my name, anything. It is your book. Got it? Okay, in your PPT, PowerPoint presentation, right? There is an option that you can write something, but that particular text will not be shown whenever you will be presenting the PPT. Do you know that? There is an option. Those who haven't prepared well, they can do the cheating. So this is the same thing. You can write anything here, but it will not be compiled or it will not be. This is just for helping us so that we can easily identify what is happening here. It is like a page mark or footnote, anything. Got it, huh? And with this particular sign, this exclamation sign, you are instructing or you are communicating with the computer that, okay, with the compiler, sorry, that this line is not for your job. You can ignore it. Your compiler will just come to the next line. Whenever the compiler will do it by line by line by line, right? Whenever the compiler will get this exclamation mark, he will be informed that, okay, this line I can skip. This is not for me. There is no job for me at this particular line. Got it, sir?
Yes, sir.
This line also and this indentation also, these are for our own convenience. So that we can easily have an idea of this 1000-line code. Long code. See? One of my friends used to do a job in a software company. So I have observed him. They used to share their codes with the online board because everyone is now working from home. So say for example, he has mailed someone a 1000-line code and he has said that okay, there is a problem in the 900 lines. So the second person, those who is reading that code, he should not go to the entire code, right? He will directly jump into the particular segment and you will get to know what is happening with this footnote here, with this exclamation mark, and it will be easy for him or her if we have used this indentations. Got it? Okay, now we will learn some of the terms. That is a keyword, variable, identifier, symbols, reserved words. What are those things? See, this Fortran language, if you can see any example, the code is written in English language, right? But few of the words like this program, like this implicit, like real, like this print, like this end, these particular English words have been already taken by those programmers who have designed the programming language. This particular word, you cannot use it. You cannot use it for what purposes? You cannot use it for assigning any variable. Right? So, these are called reserved words. They have already taken this word. So, the example of this reserved word is program, real, stop, end. And what is keyword then? The following keywords are defined in Fortran 77. Assign, backspace, log data, call, close, common, continue, data, dimension, to, else, LC, end file, all these things. So you can ask me now that what is the difference between keywords and what is the difference between reserved words? Right? Okay, we will see. Now, what is variables, right? A Fortran variable can be considered as a box that is capable of holding holding a single value of certain type. Thus, a variable has a name, and the variable name of the type. The way of choosing a name of a variable must fulfill the rules of composing a Fortran identifier. Now we will also see the identifier. Identifier symbols are the names you supply for your variables. So for this particular example, what is the example? Variables, the identifier are A, B, and level, right? The variable type is real, and you have assigned the name of those variables as A, B, and level. So those are called identifiers, and this implicit and this end, these terms are called those reserved. Words. So you cannot use this reserved word or those key words as your variable identifier. Otherwise, your compiler will get confused. They might think that you are doing some instruction to the code. So for that, you have to know what kind of keyword has been already reserved. Then anything other than those already assigned keyword, you can use it for your own program. Okay. Identifier. And identifier is the name used to identify a variable, procedure, or any other user defined item. Who is the user there? User are you and me. Means those who are doing the programming, those who are running the Fortran language, those who have created, the Fortran language, they have already taken these keywords and this reserved word. Now, we are using Fortran to make programs. So we are the end users. So, all the other words other than this assigned keywords are available for us for freely using in this variable or identifier. So Fortran must follow the following rules. It cannot be longer than 31 characters, right? We always need to have a very small length so that we have to write short. It must be composed of alphanumeric characters, means all the alphabets and all the numbers, 0 to 9, and underscore also. First character of a name must be a letter always. It is a very good practice to use first character, then any number if you want a character. Maybe A1, A2, but 1A is not allowed. Names are case insensitive, but as we go, ma'am has said that it may vary compiler to compiler. So you should consider that no, it is case sensitive, and you should have a parity. Keywords. Keywords are the special words reserved for the language. These reserved words cannot be used as identifier or names, just like we have already explained to it. So the list of keywords we will see, there are input-output related keywords. These keywords will give you an input or output. Say for example, we have seen this particular keyword, print, right? If you print something, it will give you an output, right? If you want to read something, I mean your user has been defined, your user has been put some values to a variable, and you have to store that particular variable, that particular space assigned. So you have to use this command read. Like the scanf in three, right? So these are connected to the input output thing. If you use this thing, they will be connected to either input or output. But other than the input output keyword, there are non-input output keywords also, like with allocate, call, case, continue, to. There's a huge list, right?
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, if keywords are also reserved words, what is the difference between them?
Again?
If keywords are also the reserved words, then what is the difference between them?
Okay. I exactly don't know the answer, but I can hear the list.
Sir, because in keywords, it was written these reserved words are.
Yes. Let me ask. Because we're not probably. Ma'am, can we just put some light on the question? Hello? Okay, I will check that with you. Okay. Open now. Okay, let's see that. The following keywords are defined in 47.2 assign backspace block data call plus from time to keyword. The words which will make up the Fortran language call. The words which make up the Fortran language call.
Yes,
sir.
Vishnu, were you calling for me?
Yeah, actually.
Yes, tell yes.
One of the students asked one question, but I don't have any correct answer for that. So I'm
okay, I'll try and give you a try. What is the question they asked you?
The question is if this reserved words are also keywords, right? So what is the meaning of saying keywords and reserved words as two separate things?
Okay, so if I understood the question correctly, he wants to ask the difference between.
Hello?
What he's asking is the difference between keywords and reserved words. Let us think like that. Let's see if we have the function implicit. Right now, sir was explaining the implicit. So implicit is a kind of a keyword, but it's not exactly a reserved word. We can say like that the reserved word is basically as maybe the keywords are a set of reserved words, but reserved words are much larger and wider range. Like we cannot use the word program. If we run the compiler, then you will see that some of the letters will appear in a white color. Like if we run using the online compiler, we will see some of the colorations are there in white. Like I cannot use the term intrinsic, or I cannot use the term implicit, or I cannot use the term program random. So there are certain keywords. Keywords are like if I say the let's say there are certain functions also. Those are also keywords. And reserved words are what we should not use randomly as a character, or we should not assign any variable name as a part of those reserved words. Maybe I'm not very clear. Is this answer? Did I answer it successfully?
Yeah. We got it, but still I have a little bit doubt, like the same that they are like almost the same. We cannot use either keyword or the reserved word. So there is not
a very clear cut distinction between keywords and reserved words. I also agree. The ones that are keywords and the ones that are reserved words, we cannot use either of them in naming a variable.
Yes.
I totally agree with it. And we'll see that those particular parameters, if we try to type in the compiler, it will immediately turn white. Like if I am writing A plus B, that will not be indicated in a white coloration. But if I am assigning some of the keywords, I should not name a program, a variable like program or continue or data. But yes, if you try to think like that, both of them do hold the same meaning at the end of the day.
Yes.
And so, why is it written some of the reserved words which we have seen so far? Don't we know the exact number?
No, again, my question, my answer to you when we see these reserve words and keywords, as we have also seen, it varies extremely from compiler to compiler and the version installs. Some might be using 4.2.0, some might be using 4.77. I think an exhaustive list of keywords and an exhaustive list of reserved words. The compiler that you will have know, like if a particular machine is delivered, the manufacturer, you can have a washing machine, but just imagine the different, there are various manufacturers for that washing machine. Essentially, the purpose of the washing machine will be to wash your clothes and dry it. But from manufacturer to manufacturer, a manual will come wherein the delivery, the instructions will be explicitly given to you. Very similar is a kind of a compiler. So as you move from one compiler to another compiler, the set of keywords, the set of reserved words will vary. Because originally when Fortran was devised way back, a long time back, people used it only for mathematical calculations. So at that point of time, even so much of alphabets and strings were not paid much attention. It could only understand mathematical computation. Later on, as it became a high-end computing software, the concept of introducing different amounts of variables, different amounts of strings came. So therein, there offered an expansion in these so-called keywords and so-called reserve words. But nobody can give you an exhaustive set of keyword and reserve words. I can give it to you specific to the compiler in question.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So Fortran provides 5 intrinsic data type. However, you can derive your own as well. So the 5 intrinsic data types are integer type, real type, complex type, logical type, and connected type. So what is the integer type? Integer types can only hold only integers. It cannot hold any fractions, right? So now anyone can ask a question that then, sir, what is the need of having this integer type in fraction also, in real type also, we can store those integers, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So if we can generalize it by using only real type, then what is the need of having an integer type alone? Anyone got this answer?
Sir, there might be some program which, I mean, when we will use, we only require integer values.
Obviously, there might be a program that we only require integer value. We are using only integer type. But the question is something else. The question is, the real type also can hold the integer value, isn't it? Maybe it will show 12 as 12.000. An integer type cannot hold a fraction, but a fraction can also hold a whole number, right? Then what is the point of having integer type separately? See, everything we assign to the computer, it requires one what? Memory, area, and space in the computer. So holding 12.00000 and holding only 12, there might be a slight difference in the execution of the program. So your 1000-line program can be little slow. Maybe with this modern compiler on, it should be a less than a fraction of a second. But when this Fortran and C was developed, at the initial stage, then we did not have many fast compilers and those things. So we used to assign only what is required. If I want to have one chapati, I will order only one chapati, not two. So we'll see an example. Your program testing in, you can give any input, implicit num, then integer, colon, large val, print, huge, large val, end program, testing in. Means you can also show how long your integer value will be, like this time 2. It's called short variable, or time 2 is assigned for your shorter variable, then time 4, long. kind 8, kind 16, very long, very, very long. Now, with an example, if you try to just understand this, we have printed them all. Huge, short variable, long variable, very long, and this is default variable, right? So, if we compile that, this type of data will come. With kind 2, it will not be able to hold more than these 5 numbers, right? With kind 4, this, with kind 6, 8, and so on. And if you don't use this kind here, it's also by default, they will take kind 4. So, see, this is kind 4, and this is the default thing. So, they are the same. So again, it is for if you know that we will not be able to have this huge number, you will not allocate a much bigger space to the compiler.
So yes, I couldn't follow how we got that result.
This is just an example. Don't follow these numbers, just length of it. Your integer, if you assign it integer within the bracket kind 2, it will be only able to store a short length number. If you say kind 4, it will be able to store a very long number. Therefore, for example, yes.
Sir, is that value is garbage the value?
Yes, probably is an arbitrary value. The length is only important. Length.
Later on, he will demonstrate to you with some actual numbers. What sir is now illustrating to you is the length and how the variables are taken. The simple addition and all the online compiler will be doing it with, and it will be much more clear. Okay.
Say for example, you are running a programming or you are doing a programming in which you are adding up all the semester numbers of yours. So can you expect that your semester number will be this much long?
No,
so you will be assigning only kind 2 or might be maximum kind 4, isn't it? Because you are sure of your final outcome. Again, you can say that, sir, anytime I can use kind 8 and I will allocate a huge space here. But that is the point. You will not waste the space because it will affect the compilation time. Because the compiler will go from here to here each time. He will check it whether your value is there in the last cell of your assigned space also. So depending upon your contextual requirement, you will be assigning either type 4 or type 2, anything. And if you omit this one, if you omit that this type 2 or type 4, by default, you will take type 4, which is the most expected. Right? Here. Now we move to the real-time integer. It stores the floating point number also, such as 2.0, 3.125, it can hold negative also. So traditionally there are two different types of real types, default real types and double crystal type. Again, these things depend upon up to this point how many fractions you were considering. Say for example, we used to take g is equal to 9.807 and we also used to take g is equal to 10, right? So as per your contextual need, if you are very much precise in your calculation, you will choose this one or you will just use the real type here. So we'll see one program in here. Program division implicit none. We have defined this PQ and real result as a real variable. and we have also defined I, J and integer result as integers. Now we have assigned value to this P, Q and I and J. See, P and Q are real, means it is only whole number. No, sorry. P and Q are real means it can be fractional also. And this integer type ing, it can only store whole number. So if we assign P is equal to 2 and I is equal to 2, Q is equal to 3 and J is equal to 3, as because P and Q we have defined as real numbers, they will store it as 2.0 and 3.0, not only 2, not only 1, not only 3, right? But as because we have defined I and J as integers, they will store only 2 and 3. Now, if we do P by Q and I by J, both results must come the same, isn't it? But it will not be counted as the same, as because you have defined P and Q as real and I and J as integer. So P and Q, P by Q is how much? 2 by 3 fraction, right? What is the value of 2 by 3?
0.666.
So as because your real result, it is showing, I mean, it has stored the real values of it in the fraction of it, it will show 0.666. But as because this int result, I by J will provide the same value mathematically, but as because we have assigned int result as integer, it will not be able to hold anything beyond fraction. It will only show the whole number. And what is the whole number here? Zero only. It will ignore the entire part after this point. So even though your mathematical calculation shows that both result should come 0.66, but one, it will come the original value 0.66, and if you assign it as integer only, it will show you only the integer value. So this example shows that as per your contextual need, you have to assign your variables correctly. Got it? Okay, let me ask you a question. If you have assigned this P and Q as complex variables, so what should be the result of P here? It would have stored it as 2.0 plus 0i, even if it doesn't have any complex part, but as because you would have assigned this P and Q as complex, it will store it in the expression of the complex variable. Got it? So if you are adding the heights of your colleagues, 100 students, you are summing up the heights, you are finding out the variation, you are doing the average and all, your height cannot be a complex number, isn't it? So you will never assign height as a complex number. It is up to you. But even you mistakenly assign your height as a complex number, your answer will not change. Just the space allocation and the computational time might vary the fraction of the second. And your final outcome can be expressed in a different way. Your 2 will be expressed as 2 plus 0 i. This much difference you will have. Clear? See, yes. Programming is like your computer as your is a kid. He or she doesn't know anything. You have to instruct him or her small details also. He or she is not intelligent enough that he or she will interpret that, okay, height cannot be fractional or no. Height can be fractional. Height can be fractional and height cannot be complex number, imaginary number. So I will automatically choose here real, not even integer, not even complex, because height can be fractional and it can never be a complex number. But the compiler, or the code prediction is not smart enough to anticipate all these things. Now I will answer these questions. Your keyword, your result was very well. See, even if I don't know what is the exact difference between your keywords and reserve words, this kind of question will never come to your exam. What is keyword? Define keywords. No.
May I just interrupt here for a minute?
Yes.
Actually, what we are teaching them, the portal is here just an example. This is very much applicable to all the different software languages. It is applicable to Fortran, it is applicable to Python, it is applicable to C. So as far as I can recollect, even I have done Fortran during my UG days, as such Fortran doesn't have any very clear-cut distinction between a keyword and a reserved word, but some languages have. Like all keywords are reserved words, but maybe the reverse is not true. Let us, if we take the example of, say Java, let's say Java. There, what all of them cannot be used as identifiers. There is a specific term called identifiers, right? So in that case, there are only some words which can be used as identifiers. If we take the example of a particular command like go to, there is a command in Java which is called go. That is a reserved word, but it is not a keyword at all. So just in the context of Fortran, maybe Fortran has a very vague distinction between a reserved word and a keyword. But what we can understand for the time being is that most keywords are reserved words and vice versa for majority of the programming languages, except for languages. Like one language which I can think of was Java. For Python, I cannot remember right now. There is a some command, like I gave you an example of a go to command. That is not at all a keyword, but it is a reserved word. So what we are learning is a generalized depiction which is true for each and every programming language. So students, my request to you is when sir is explaining something to you, do not take it solely in the context of Fortran. Just learn it in the context of a programming language, then your genre will be, the expanse will be much wider in that case. That is all.
Yes. Okay. So for now, you can just consider these keywords and reserved words are the segment of words that has been already, the programming languages is acquainted already. Programming language is acquainted with this word, with each and every keyword or reserved word, whatever. Say for example, in or go to, this one. Let's explain it with a particular keyword, that is go to. Go to means whenever you are applying or you are using this word go to, a particular set of instructions are anticipated by the compiler or for the programming language. Because the programming language knows this word, that go to means after this, this kind of instructions will come, nothing else will come. This go to word has been taught to the compiler. The creator of Fortran, they have assigned some kind of job instructions to this particular keyword, right? And they have kept all the other anything, Chinese words also, but in English language for you to play with. You can set them identifier. This is for you. This is for the user and role, and this is for the creator role. Creator, see, in a dictionary, for example, there are 10,000 words, right? So they have taken hundreds of them so that they can create this Fortran language, and 9,900 what they have kept open so that you can use it as per your requirement. So you cannot use this keywords or reserved word, whatever, for assigning any variable name. But again, if you use those things in those, I mean, after this explanation works, probably your computer will not mind, because he will just keep that particular name. Got it? Okay, now I was telling really good. So your programming language is not that smart that you have said that you have set a variable height. Your question was to measure the height, take the inputs of the height of your 100 colleagues, and you will have to identify the maximum one, you have to identify the average one, and you have to identify the standard deviation one. This is your assignment, and you have assigned the variable height. As because this height, this particular word, is not within the known boundary of the Fortran compiler as keywords or as reserved words, whatever, it will not identify you and it will not suggest you that, okay, I know what this word height means. So I will automatically assign this variable as real, not as complex, not as real. You will not be able to interpret that. Got that idea? If you use height, that particular word is not included in your keywords, you have the responsibility to define it properly. That, okay, with this height, I want to store only fraction numbers. I don't want to store this complex number. And don't restrict itself as just an integer. Then you, it is your responsibility to describe or assign properly your identifiers or your variable names. But if you use go to your computer, your compiler already knows the exact thing that, okay, now this kind of statement will come. You are not allowed to do anything with this go to word. If you use this go to word and after 3-4 lines segment, you exactly have to use as per their predefined instruction. You have to write in that particular fashion only. You have to speak in that particular accent only. Otherwise, will give an error because it is known to the person. It is expecting the exact formatting with which it is created. Clear? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, clear.
Clear type. Now, complex type. Obviously, this is used for storing a complex number. So complex number has two. Okay. By the way, what is the use of complex number? In engineering, in science, or what is the practical implementation or interpretation of complex numbers? Anyone? We all know the formula of complex number, right? How to use it, how to just calculate. But what is the practical meaning of complex number? Do you guys know that? At least search in the internet, right? Okay. Moving on. For example, a complex number 3.0, -5.2 is equal to 3.0 -5.0 i. We will do it detail in the number chapter. But there is also an expression of, I mean, that in this complex type also. Now, the third one is logical type. There are only two logical values, either true or false. True means current on, false means current off. And character type. The character types are those two.
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, it is dot true or dot false.
Dot.
Means true. Dot will be there, no?
Dot. These are those syntax words. If you omit this dot, it doesn't mean that your IQ is low. It means that you are not acquainted, you are not accustomed with the syntax of this particular Fortran language. For C, it might be something else. For Java, it might be something else. So learning Fortran means you have to know the exact syntax of, you have to speak in the language of Fortran, right? See, just like the difference of American accent and British accent, they are saying the exact same thing, but in a different axis. Now the character type. The character type shows the character and the string. The length of the string can be specified by the length specifier. If not, if no specified length is done, it is one. But the particular example we will see when we will be doing the example. Implicit typing, we have already done it. Fortran variables, we have already covered it. Integer, real, complex, logical. This logical is Boolean. Either it is true or it is false. Right? We have almost covered it. Complex. See, if you want to assign integer, you have to write integer, then colon. If you have to assign real, then real, colon, complex, colon, logical, colon. But whatever you will be writing on the right hand side, that is completely up to you. You can write a total, you can write a error dot also, you can write a total one, total two, anything. But this syntax must be exactly the same as the compiler understands. So these things we can see. Okay, this is the final output. If you have assigned integer here, it will be shown like this way. If you assign real, it will be shown in the fractional form. And if you have assigned complex here, then it will be shown as 3 point something, comma, 5 point something. Even if you have taken the value of only 3, it will show 3.000, comma, 0.000. But the way of expression will be similar to the your assigned thing. Operators. Now, as because you have known that Fortran was already invented for doing mathematical operation initially, and we are engineers, we will be using also Fortran for our mathematical calculations. Now, so mathematical reasoning should be there. Like what kind of reasoning? Arithmetic operators, relational operators, and logical operators. We will see it one by one. Arithmetic operators, you guys all know, as because learning any programming language just requires the knowledge of your 10th standard. So operator is plus, so this is called addition, a plus b. If a holds 5 and b holds 3, then a plus b will give a minus b will give 2, a into b. See, the learnable thing is while doing multiplication, you have to make this star a into b. Got it? So you cannot do it cross. Then it will show an error. So a into b will be 15, a by b will be 1. Why a by b will be given 1?
Integers are not.
Yes. Because a is 5, b is 3, it will be fraction. It, as because we have assigned the integer value, it will take only the whole part of it, right? So the whole number part of it. And exponential operators. It will not write here 10 to the power x or u to the power x. It will write a double star. 5 to the power 3 will be expressed as 5 star star 3. Right? So this small thing you have to remember. Relational operator. Assume a variable a holds 10 and then b holds 20. Then, so a is 10, b is 20, right? So if equal, it will check whether it is equal or not, but it will show the operator is equal. If you type only equal, it will not work, right? So check if the values of the two operators are equal or not. If yes, then the condition begin. As because a was 10 and b was 20, Yes, yes. So A is not equal to B, and if you write A equal to B, it is not true, right? Then similarly, not equal to, it is like this thing, greater than, as because A is not greater than B, it is not true. Less than, it will be obviously true, and you can see the rest of the examples. This is called what? Relational operator. That's because they are comparing A and B, and they are giving the answer whether the statement is true or not. See, these things have been used in loops. So this is a checking points, right? So you can say that, okay, if A is equal to B, then go to path number 1, and if A is not equal to B, then go to path number 2. So your compiler will check whether your A or B are equal or not, and as per the outcome, whether it is true or not, he will choose the exact path you are assigning. Right? Okay. 1 minute. Logical operator. So the operator is AND, for logical AND. If both the operators are non-zero, then conditions become the true. So A and B is false. How? Called logical AND operator, if both the operands are non-zero, then conditions become true. How? Think. What is it? See, logical operators is, logical operators and quotas work only in logical, true or false, right? The following table shows all the logical operators supported by Fortran. Assume variable A holds true and variable B holds false. So A is true, B is false. A is 1, B is 0, right? So AND, for logical AND, if both the operators are non-zero, but as because in this particular case, A is true and B is false, means this A and B statement is false. And this logical AND operator means both A and B have to be true or non-zero. Got it? No? Can anyone remember AND gate, OR gate, huh? All this. OR means this is logical, or if any of the two operators is non-zero, then the conditions become. Means this OR gate will allow you to go to the second stage of the game if anyone have the key. So as because A was positive, B was not, then the A or B statement is true. You can also see which is not equivalent also. Now the operator's precedence is in Fortran. Like in your calculator also, if you put a multiple sign, it will be executed first. If you put a divided sign, which is nothing but a reverse multiplication, it will be executed first. Then your positive and negative sign. So this is the order in which the Fortran compiler will execute this thing. So examples, first exponential, then multiplication or division, then addition or subtraction, then this thing. So this is the operation. Different decisions, Okay, this decision thing is important as because this will finally help you to do in programming. Decision making structure requires that a programming specify one or more conditions to be evaluated or tested by the program along with a statement or statements to be executed if the condition is determined to be true and optionally other statements to be executed if the condition that will false. Means there might be cases that if your velocity exceeds this much value, then you have to take this kind of calculation. If your velocity is less than this, you have to have a different set of expression. If your structure has a factor of safety this much, then you have to follow this code. If your factor of safety is beyond this much, then you have to follow those particular codes. Means as per your outcome of your logical reasoning thing, different path of executions may be there. Again, as per the outcome of your logical reasoning, calculation, whatever, your further steps may be multiple times. You may choose one of them, but depending upon your outcome of your previous step. So if a condition is there, if your program satisfies that, or your input calculation, whatever, if your input or calculation satisfies a particular condition, then it will follow this particular path. This path may have one line code, two line code, set of code, anything, but at least it will channelize your program, your compiler, and follow this particular path. Else, if your condition is failed, then it will ignore this particular set of instructions. It will follow a different path and it will be joined here. Means this entire path will not be executed. So only one option can be there. This program will come from this point to that point, then either it will follow this path or it will follow this path. Both of the paths will never be executed at simultaneously. And your condition, your logical operation is set here. Got it? Hello? So now we'll see some examples in loops. There may be a situation when you need to execute a block of code several number of times. Iteration time. In general, statements are executed sequentially. The first statement is a function is executed first, followed by the second, and so on. Programming languages provide the variation of control structure that allow for more complete execution. First, a loop statement allows us to execute a statement or two statements multiple times, and following is the general. Okay. See, a program starts from here. It goes to check that condition. So, if the condition is true, it will execute this set of conditional code and will come again here. Means unless this condition comes to be false, it will execute the same path over and over again and again, repeatedly, iteration, right? And when this condition will come false, then it will exit that loop and follow this alternate path. So means you will provide a condition here, and on the basis of this condition, you will be assigning your compiler that you have to execute this conditional code for multiple times. Your basic objective is you want this conditional code to be executed for 40 times. So you have to set a condition here that at the 41st time, it will come false. Say, for example, you have set n is equal to 1 here, and your n will increase up to 40. So, first n will 1, your condition will be satisfied. The code will execute this conditional code. Now, your n is 2 with an increment of 1, again it will come. N is 3, again it will come. Like this ways, when your n will overcome surpass 40, then your condition will be false, then it will be executed. So this is the loop formation. We will understand this with an example. But before that, we will see what kind of loop is there in Fortran. Do loop, do while loop, and nested loops. Do loop. This construct enables a statement. This do loop construct enables a statement or a series of statements to be carried out iteratively while a given condition is true. We will see this with an example. Not this example. Okay. So this is the general syntax of do loop. Do variable start, stop, and steps. Into and these are the executable statements. So start is the initial value, right? And because do loop is for what? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Do loop is used for what purposes? In iteration purposes, right? So we have to have one starting point, we have to have one finishing point also, and we have to have one increment also. For any kind of iteration, we have to have three things. You will start from 1, or you start from 0, or you start from 3, anything. 1, 2, or 3 is not important. But the important thing is you have to have a starting point. Say, for example, this is 1. You have to have a finish point also, say for example 40, and you have to implement the value of n also, so that the first time it is n is equal to 1, second time it is n is equal to 2, third time it is n is equal to 3, like when your execution will be 40 times, then you will execute the loop, right? So we will see this with an example. Okay, and if you omit this particular term, your increment term, then computer will automatically consider that is that the increment is of unit. Means first n will be 1, then n will be 2, then n will be 3. But if you mention here the increment is 4, so your first time n will be 1, and the next run n will be how much? N will be 5. So your 40 will come in just 8 steps. So now this is
the start means we are initializing.
Yes, yes. Start means the starting point of your iteration, number of iteration. If your iteration, if you are trying to iterate for 100, so your starting point will be 1 and your finishing point will be 100. And your increment, either you could not define it, you will take it automatically as 1 unity, 1 then 2 then 2 then 3, or you have to assign that my incremental value is also 1. Got it?
Yes, sir.
So, 2 n is equal to 1, comma 10 means they have not assign the incremental value here, but computer will automatically take it as unity, and the starting point is 1 and the finishing point is 10. So n will be iterated 10 times. Now n factorial, they are actually computable factorial. N factorial is n factorial into n. So it will be right. Will be giving us a factorial thing, as because if you will do 1 into 2 into 3 into up to 10. So in the first step, they will be calculating 1 into 2. In the second iteration, they will be multiplying 3. In the third, they will be multiplying 4. Like this way, they will start from 1, they will end up 10, and they will give you the final results. Right. So we'll see another example here. This example prints the numbers from 11 to 20. So program user comment print number implicit none define variables. We have defined an integer n, as because we don't think that to print from 11 to 20 we need either a complex number or a real number, right? So do n 11 comma 20 with an incremental value of unity. We are printing the value of n, as because we want to be our result to be 11, 12, 13, and up to 20. So each time, see, let me ask you one question. Did you guys notice that this 11, 12, 13, 14, up to 20 has been printed in different lines?
Yes, sir.
Why is it so? Because after each iteration, it is printing n. Then it is again come to the next iteration line. So at the first line, it has started n is equal to 11. It has printed the value of n is equal to 11.
But then, sir, here it is space. So there should be space between 11 and 12. Why the line is taking?
That is my question. That is my question. See. If you
consider, in C, we use backslash n.
No, see, here is it. They have printed n. Correct. So the first, so 11 is the print outcome of the first iteration when n is equal to 11. Then it will again come here and it will make n equal to 12 with an increment of an unity. And they will again print n as 12. Then it again goes up to the loop. Up to this, they will continue up to 20. Whenever n is equal to 20, n reaches 20 here, they will exit this particular set of instructions. They will not print
new. And so, what do we type if we want to type it in one line?
Okay, then we have to check the compiler for particular thing. Then you have to open the online link and you have to just click it. That will be right. But the logic in this particular example is they are doing this set of, here there is only one set of instruction, print n, and they doing it for n is equal to 11 up to n is equal to 20, and they are printing it each and every time, right?
Yes, sir. And sir, if we want to increase by 4, then where should we write that 4? Between 11
here.
And 20?
No. The syntax is just considered here. If the increment you want to assign, you have to write it after your initial and end value. Here, this is the increment. Okay. This is the factorial from 1 to 10, similar kind of example, integer.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
So it is 526.
Okay, so we are almost done. This okay, we can go to the next lesson. Okay, so in the next class, what we'll do, we will do some examples, and in the third class, we will be taking your class test. Ma'am? Hello? Remember, ma'am? Hello?